Hello DTIP, my name is Lucas Blanc. I'm a PhD student working at MBDA France for a cyber defense thesis in partnership with the C2Zen Laboratory and the support of the DGA. The topic of my thesis is about thermal management of onboard electronics using diphasic active cooling systems. During this presentation, I will show you a study about the characterization of mobility of charge dissociated species in the electric fluids for EHD pumping microsystems. But first, let me introduce the two entities who lead this study. A quick word about MBDA's activity. MBDA is a European leader in missiles conception, development and manufacturing, providing systems for the three armed forces. More specifically, I'm working in the electronic engineering entity, in the assembly and prototype department, in charge of development and conception of electronic solutions meeting the military environment's needs. The second partner of the project is the C2Zen for Center for Nanosciences and Nanotechnology, which is an academic laboratory, part of the very new Paris-Saclay University and the CNRS. It employs about 450 people and owns the biggest clean room for research in Île-de-France. I'm working mainly with their microsystem and microfluidic department. Okay, let's move to the subject. Here is a summary of the presentation. First, I will make a quick introduction about the context of the project and more specifically the EHD conduction pumping. Then, we will see a theoretical approach of the characterization mobility of charged species in the electric liquids and the associated simulation obtained. After that, I will present you the bench developed for this specific characterization. We will see next the first result obtained using the bench. And finally, we will have some conclusion and perspective for the project. So first, introduction. What is the context of this study? The aim of my thesis is to find and develop a heat transfer technology compatible with harsh military environments. This means, for example, compatible with temperature range from 55 degrees below zero and 125 degrees above, but also extended lifetimes, about 20 to 30 years, for example. So, we selected a heat transfer technology, which is two-phase loops technology. Such thermal management systems are made of a closed loop from hot point to a cold source, as you can see on the picture below, draining the heat by fast changing and convection of the fluid. They are already used in some electronic applications, like laptops or smartphones, and demonstrate very low thermal resistances associated with high heat transfer capability, and so far better performances than actual heat transfer systems for electronics in most of the onboard military applications. However, actual two-phase loops can't be used in such application because their performances are highly impacted by acceleration gradients due to their passive capillary pumping for the fluid convection. The solution we propose to solve this issue is to add an active pumping to the loop in order to assist the capillary pumping during the high acceleration gradients. This pump is based on EHD conduction phenomenon. So, EHD pump, how does it work? The EHD conduction pumping is a phenomenon that appears in specific dielectric fluids when they are polarized under an applied voltage. The principle is simple, as you can see on the bottom picture. When charged pieces are placed in an electric field, they are moving along this field in a direction imposed by their electric charge. If they are in an environment, let's say, composed of neutral species, like in a dielectric fluid, for example, they will interact with this environment and so give some energy to the environment and generate a draining of the neutral species and so the fluid. In the case of a symmetric system, and if the charged species are all the same, there will be no draining because the energy given to drain the fluid from the left to the right is equal to the energy given to drain the fluid from the right to the left. But EHD conduction pumping appears then there if there is an asymmetry of the electric field in the system, but also if there is a difference of interaction of positively and negatively charged species with the environment. This like characteristic is described by the mobility of charged species in the fluid. We will see in the next slides how these species appear in the electric fluid. And so, the aim of this study is to find a way to characterize the mobility of charged species in the electric fluids in order to find the best one for EHD pumping. You can see on the two first pictures of this slide some EHD pumps we build during my thesis. We will now see the theoretical approach of the bench development. First, let's see how charged species appear in dielectric liquids. Charged species appear in dielectric liquids by dissociation of the neutral species following this formula. Where there is no polarization imposed on the liquids, electroneutrality is respected in the bulk, and dissociation and recombinations are balanced. When there is a polarization imposed on the liquid, the recombination rate is not affected by the electric field, as you can see on this formula. But the dissociation rate depends on the imposed electric field, following this formula. This means that under polarization, there will be an increase in the dissociation species concentrations in the liquid. Now, what about the charge repartitions inside the liquid? As said in the previous slide, ions are moving towards the electrode of opposite charge following the electric field, and are accumulating at the vicinity of the electrodes, forming an area named electrical double layer. This electrical double layer is screening the electric field imposed on the liquid, and so electroneutrality is reached in the bulk at steady state. This time, dissociation rate and recombination rates are equal, and it is considered at the initial time for our simulations. Okay, now let's see the carrier transport equations. So for the general case, we got two equations, one for each of the charged species. I will now describe the terms inside the equations. So P is for the concentrations of positive carriers, N is for the concentrations of negative carriers, C is the concentrations of neutral species inside the fluid. We also got the mobility for the positive and the negative carriers here, and their diffusion coefficient here. And finally, we have the velocity of the liquid here. We have made some hypotheses for our specific case. And these hypotheses are, first, the liquid is at rest all the time. The dissociation and recombination are neglected during the carrier transport. This means that at the initial time, there are some concentrations of carriers, but this concentration is not evolving in the time, along the time. Next, we have a constant electric field in the liquid. We have seen in the previous slide that this is true in the bulk of the liquid and not in the electrical double layer. After that, we have the liquid that is a perfect insulator. And finally, we have no charge injections phenomenon at electrodes interface. So now, if we focus on the positive carriers, it's the same for the negative carriers, of course. We obtained a normalized differential equations for a one-dimensional case. We see that it appears in these equations a characteristic time of flight depending on the electrode gap, the polarizations, and the carrier's mobility. It corresponds to the time taken by most of the carriers to fly from one electrode to the opposite one. And we also see that the evolution of the carrier concentrations is dependent at the second order of a parameter linked to the diffusion coefficients of the carrier. Now, using this equation, we perform the simulation using a Python code with the finite difference discretization. In a first step, we imposed a reverse polarity to the system in order to create the initial repartition of the charged species in the electrical double layer as I described two slides ago. Then, in a second step, we impose a new polarity, a direct polarity, and we simulate the carrier traveling from their initial position to the opposite electrode. In this short video, you will see the second step. On top, the repartition of the concentration on species in the liquid, and on bottom, the current response of the system. As you can see, we observed a wave traveling of the charged species from one electrode to the other, with a diffusion of the concentration during the traveling due to the term of the second order in the equation. If we look now at the current response of the system, two cases can be observed. The first one corresponds to no mobility difference between the charge carriers. This is the case you can see on these curves. Then, three regimes are observed. First, a fast transient. Then, a plateau corresponding to the sweeping out of the species to the opposite electrode, dependent on the ion mobility and the applied electric field. And finally, we have a decrease of the current to zero, at a characteristic time linked to the time of flight of the species. The time of flight can be extracted from these curves as it corresponds to the middle of the decrease dynamic. I would like to precise that in this chart, all the curves are normalized in time. But in fact, the curves with 2 volts applied the dynamic is far slower than with 10 volts. For example. Second case, there is a large difference between the mobility of positively and negatively charged species. In that case, the current, which is the superposition of the contributions of both species traveling, demonstrates two plateaus with two decreasing regimes due to one species reaching the opposite electrodes before the other one. Then, it is possible to find two times of flight linked to the mobility of the two species, as you can see on these curves, for example. The current response is then not sufficient to deduce which one of the dissociated species is linked to each time of flight. And so we need additional tests using, for example, an EHD pump device with symmetrical design of electrodes to be able to determine which one of the carriers is linked to which one of the time of flight. Okay, that's all for the simulations. I will now describe the test bench we developed based on these simulations. The test bench is mainly composed of a cylindrical PTFE chamber equipped with 3 copper electrodes, a top electrode that is the polarization electrode that will be polarized positively or negatively, and a collecting electrode, which is the bottom electrode, surrounded by a guard electrode to prevent the current leakage and the fringing field effect. For the power supplied, we use 2 high voltage power supplies, one positive with 20 kilovolt possibility, and one negative with 5 kilovolt negative power supply. For the current measure, we used a femto ammeter from Keysight. And this setup has been fully automated using a Python code. So you have on the right a view of the liquid enclosure of the bench. For the measurements, we determined an experimental protocol according to the simulations. First, we want to generate the dissociated species and the electrical double layer repartitions by imposing an high electric field until a steady state is reached. We call this step the reverse polarization step, and you can see the current response during this step on the right. Then, we switch the polarization to the direct polarization for the measurement of the current response. For this step, we impose a smaller electric field in order to limit the charge injection phenomenon at the electrode interfaces. Here you can see the liquid we tested with the bench. We performed measurement over 8 liquids, and this table is showing the permittivity and the conductivity of the liquid we tested, which are important properties that allow us to deduce the relaxation time of each liquid. The relaxation time is a characteristic time for the recombinations of the dissociated species inside the liquids, and you may note that for most of the tested liquids, this time is about 10 microseconds, but we also have several seconds of reaction time for some liquids. The fluids of the Novec family are some hydrofluoroether fluids, already known as good EHD pumping fluids, While the FC72 is fluoroxane and the Galden is perfluoropolyether. Now, if we observe the result, we obtain two kinds of current response depending on the tested liquids. In the case of most of the hydrofluoroethers and acetone, a current peak is observed, like the red curve in the chart. In the case of the Galden, the Novex 649 and the FC72, we observe no current peak, even at high electric fields, like in the blue curve in the chart. We can discuss about this result, and there are three main points. First, the measured current is not fitting with the theoretical model because we only have one current peak and not a plateau and not even a fast transient at the beginning. We don't observe a difference between the mobility of positively and negatively charged species. And finally, we observe that the current peak is voltage dependent, but also dependent on the gap between the electrodes, which means that this current peak has the same is dependent on the same parameters than the time of flight of our charged species. However, based on literature, this maximum of current time of the curve can be interpreted as the time of flight of the charged species in first approximation. We can also discuss about the possible causes involving these results. The first cause may be the superposition of the charge injections that masks the dissociations species traveling from one electrode to the other by charge injections at one electrode. Then we have a time of flight that is far higher than the relaxation time in most of the tested liquids. This means that there is an important recombination during traveling, unlike we've made the hypothesis during the simulations. And in the case where there is no measured peak, for Galden, for example, the applied electric field is maybe not sufficient to generate a non-equilibrium between the dissociation and the recombination rates. Okay, if we didn't observe the current responses we expected, there are two possibilities. We can have some issues with the experiments, or we can have a wrong model. So we have looked at other results found in the literature with measurements performed on a comparable characterization bench, but for another dielectric liquid, which is this time an hydrofluorocarbon. And you can see the results below. These results are well fitting with our theoretical model, because we can see the fast transient regime, the plateau, and the decreasing currents, and then we can deduce the time of flight depending on the applied voltage. So it confirms the relevance of the model as long as the initial hypotheses are respected. Plus, we also see, looking at the properties of the liquid, that the relaxation time of this liquid is still small compared to the time of flight. So that may indicate that the small relaxation time is not the main cause of our result not fitting with the model. So, for the conclusions and perspective of the project, we developed a methodology for charged species mobility characterization, and we proposed a theoretical model in order to describe the phenomenon. We've made simulations based on this model, and simulations fit with results in the literature. So, we built a characterization test bench according to the simulation hypothesis, but first results obtained on dielectric fluid tested are not fitting with simulations. However, mobility can still be extracted from the measurement in first approximations. So, first, the perspectives. We want to use the bench with a reference read, so with a long relaxation time, with known negatively and positively charged species mobility, in order to confirm the feasibility of the measure. Then we could improve the bench by adding, for example, a third power supply with a smaller voltage range in order to make a measurement at lower voltage under 100 volts, for example, in order to decrease the charge injection phenomenon during the measurement. We could also decrease the working distance between the electrodes in order to decrease the recombinations by decreasing the time of flight of the charged species. Thank you for the listening of this presentation. If you have any questions, feel free to contact me and see you at DTIP 2021.